Our last panel of the day is moderated by Strategy Analytics Roger Lanctot, along with Vice President of Urban Mobility Programs from Maven GM and Chief Product Office of Moovel Daimler, Matt Jones.
Oh.
Okay, just in case you haven't heard enough about car sharing today, we're going to dig into some more car sharing. With one of the biggest car makers in the world, GM, and with probably the leading multimodal application, Moovel. So one of the big challenges about the trying to deliver this new mobility proposition is the plumbing, the logistics involved. So maybe, Rachel, you could start this conversation by describing what is involved and how many moving parts really there are in Maven, because I have to be frank with you, I'm confused. Even just a few months in, I'm still not crystal clear on all the moving pieces within Maven. So could you tell us what's happening?
Yeah, it is definitely complex. We're able to leverage a lot of the existing infrastructure that's in place within the OEM, but that means we're tapping into new car supply. We're tapping into things like off-rental, off-lease, in order to bring them in. Oh. So we have this whole machine we're getting into.
Let's dial it back. I'm thinking in terms of what are the solutions that you are providing in the market.
Sure.
And maybe, you know, what the broader organization consists of that you've put together, because I think there's several different pieces that GM put together to deliver this new story.
Correct. So we launched in January, and since then we've come to market with three different products. So the first is our Maven City, which is what you would probably think of as conventional car sharing, although we've attempted to reinvent that with a much better user experience. The second is a residential application, which feels much more like a dedicated fleet of cars that are based at a residence. And then the third is our rideshare offering. So we've created the Express Drive program with Lyft, and that is a car rental for rideshare drivers to use for commercial purposes. So those are the big three product offerings.
And when you say to use for commercial purposes, can you?
They're earning on the Lyft platform.
Okay. And I was talking to your colleague, Paul Pebbles.
Yes.
And he was saying, he was a little bit confused at your title, Maven Commercial. Can you clarify that exactly?
Sure. So my emphasis is really on the business-to-business or commercial side. So that would include Express Drive with Lyft, but that also includes a growing array of portfolio products that we're going to be bringing out soon. And that's more focused on commercial fleets that would be used, as an example, on a large employer's campus or some of those other applications where it's less about straight to consumer and more about creating opportunities for employers or other commercial accounts.
So it sounds like this is going to get even more confusing for mere mortals like me.
Potentially, yes.
Okay. Yeah. But it's an interesting proposition because Ford purchased a company,
yep.
GM created a company. Can you talk a little bit about that? And in the conversation with Paul, what was interesting to me was that you're not really using the OnStar connected car platform. You have your own solution.
We do, but it is rooted in the work that was done on the OnStar platform as long as decades ago. So we've now taken it to another level, but the ability to work with a portfolio of vehicles with embedded connectivity was a major asset for us. It's one of the reasons we were able to build it ourselves. So many of the capabilities already existed.
Okay. Well, it's interesting to me because it sounds like, to some extent, GM has put this in the fleet space, but not within the existing fleet division.
That's fair. I would say today, really, the fleet space consists of the program with Lyft, for the most part.
Okay.
And so it's fairly distinct from our traditional fleet.
Okay. Now, Matt, your solution is completely different from Maven, with a whole grab bag of moving parts. So the thing I found most interesting from our conversation earlier today was the fact that, and I didn't really put this together, Maybe I understood it somewhere in the deep recesses, but your operation is completely separate from Car2Go, although Car2Go is part of it. So can you explain the solutions that you're offering to consumers and how your product manifests itself in the marketplace?
Of course. So we're slightly older than Maven. The roots for Moovel in the US go back to 2008 with Globe Sherpa, and then later the Ride Scout, a concept out of Austin, Texas. At the moment, we have around 2 million specific riders in the US alone, about another 400,000 to 600,000 in Europe, mostly in Germany. And our route to market, effectively, is by working with transit agencies, transit authorities, to have rider apps. So this is the apps that you might download in a variety of cities across the US to procure day passes or tickets, rather than using the cash in the machines. And we're owned by Daimler Financial Services, and we work alongside Car2Go, we work alongside MyTaxi in Europe, but we're very much focused on driving people to public transit and understanding how people ride public transit today with the aim of innovating and working with many government agencies to do so.
Okay. Now, you mentioned similar to existing car sharing, but with an enhanced user experience. Mm-hmm. So can you talk about that a little bit,
sure.
Rachel?
Yeah, a lot of it leverages the connectivity technology that we have to work with. And one of the features that I think is really the most interesting is that we've been able, in a cyber secure way, to make your cell phone the key to the car. So a Maven member that has downloaded the app can go to the car they've reserved, it will recognize them, they can unlock the car, they can get in and they can drive. There's no physical key, there's no need for any kind of a prox key, the phone becomes that. And so from an operations perspective, as well as from a consumer experience perspective, it's simpler, it's cleaner, it's much more intuitive for our members. So that's really been an elevated experience for them.
Correct me if I'm wrong, is that a first time implementation of that kind of technology in the industry?
I believe so.
Okay. And so that's available right now?
That's available now in all of our cities, yeah.
And your current geographic coverage is?
13 cities. We were just counting them up this morning. We're launching more soon. I can rattle them all off if you want, but it's most of the major metros. And we just launched in LA fairly recently.
And a total of how many cars?
Oh, several hundred.
Okay.
It's increasing by the week, so right. I'd have to pull it for you.
And subscribers?
Subscribers. So the residential offering covers 4,000. I think Maven in totality is around 13,000 to 14,000. We really more measure it in miles because we think of it as a share of transportation.
Right.
So we're at, for Maven all in, there were about 30 million miles so far.
Now, I think there's a perception, oh yeah, they just stuck these cars on the street, but you have to really kind of drive this application into the marketplace, right? I mean, it doesn't just happen.
No, you do. I think if you build a better product, people are intrigued by it. We've had a lot of great word of mouth. We've had excellent uptake on social media. So it isn't sort of your traditional automotive advertising or marketing, and I think you can probably speak to that as well. Mm. So it is different, but yes, of course. I mean, you have to build a brand. You have to explain what that means. It's a nascent space for some people, and so explaining what the experience even is, and that can be a little challenging.
And I'm kind of curious as to what your background is.
Not automotive at all. We were just talking about this backstage. I came over from Starbucks, so yeah.
Which, if you think about it, does link into transportation. We know from our riders today that there's an awful lot of people get off a train and look for the local coffee shop.
Yeah.
So I think some of the learning for what people do at either end of that transit is actually critical going forward. We know as well, and we've been discussing this, that it's very rare that somebody takes a Maven, a Car2Go, a Reach Now for the entire journey. And it's really about these multiple modes of transit. If I walk here, how long am I going to have to wait for a bus? When I get to the other end, what is the closest ride share? What is the closest shared ownership model vehicle in order to complete that journey? And we're really seeing the local infrastructure in terms of the mom and pop coffee shops and others stitch into that network. And if you think in the future, when we are in megacities and we do have locally owned shops, services, it's going to be really important that that transit network forms part of the community and really starts to drive people to those establishments. It's almost a case of alerting people to what's around them when they're in an autonomous shared ride or sitting there on the bus looking at their social network. And that's where I really think the power of public shared ownership, non-driving transit can come in, giving people time back, allowing them to socialize. And I've heard you say before that in China, the distraction to using the social media is driving. And that's becoming more and more common in the US. And services like ours are starting to move the needle when it comes to those elements.
And it's opening up an entirely different sort of set of customers and clientele. So you're serving GM, but you're also serving the customer. Mm-hmm. You're also serving the city and transit agencies, which are part of the city, of course. But that's a very different proposition. So how long have you been wrestling with this? Have you been on board since January?
I have. So in fact, I joined last October when we were setting it up. So been with General Motors since 2014, and then Maven since October 15. But it's funny. I think you'll see more and more people moving in. In fact, it's already happening with Maven, with a non-automotive background, for the simple reason that it's a services business. And so the idea of repeat and loyalty and the experience being flawless is very fundamentally different than the idea of an infrequent but very well-researched purchase of a vehicle. We may be an impulse, but yet we want you to have such an amazing experience with your Maven that you always come back. Okay. And that's a very different operating model.
You're begging me to ask this question because the industry is looking at becoming a B2C proposition where it's historically been B2B selling to dealers. Mm-hmm. And so what was the experience like joining GM from Starbucks and seeing the sort of different customer orientation? Just to put you on the spot a little bit.
No, it's
a little
fine.
Bit.
It's fine. I joined General Motors actually in a strategy role, and my group head, which is Julia Stain, who's now the head of Maven, came from an investment banking background. We have people from everywhere. So frankly, even from the get-go, I was a part of, I would call it sort of an atypical, I was never in the core business. I think Matt's very, it's kind of different. We were just contrasting our backgrounds. But frankly for me, it was very much the same. I was surprised at the level of overlap. It's, at the end of the day, I think there's a misconception that OEMs is full of these like stodgy people in suits.
Well, now wait a minute. They brought in some personnel from Sidecar and some other organizations, so you weren't alone as an outsider, as it were.
Yep.
Okay. So, but am I hearing that people are willing to listen, you know, who were already on board the ship?
Yes, very much so. And that, frankly, I think when you go into something like this, you never know, is this going to be a core business for the company? Is this a project that may get, you know, you just don't know. And we've been phenomenally well supported by leadership. So we've had support from Mary, we've had support from Dan Ammon, we've had everybody coming out. Internally, you know, direct reports at the most senior levels of the company have volunteered things that I would have not wanted to ask because it would have felt like an imposition. And yet they're coming and saying, well, we think we could make this work and we can move this for you and we can change these terms. And it's really been exciting to watch. I think at the end of the day, people want to feel like they're making a difference in their career. And that's true of everybody, I think, of every company. And General Motors is no exception. If you think about the engineering talent at the global OEMs, I mean, that's a talent pool that I think most startups would kill to have. And not only do we have it, but we represent a really exciting opportunity for people within the company to see this vision coming to life. And we've been massively oversubscribed whenever we've had a job opening, both from external and internal candidates. So it's, I think there's a lot more innovation and a lot more entrepreneurial spirit within the global OEMs than people really give proper credit for. It's been there all along, frankly.
Well, it does seem that there's a very substantial internal mandate to make this thing happen, make it happen quickly, which speaks to what I asked about earlier, which is your own bespoke hardware solution in the car, hardware and software, that you could iterate on more rapidly.
Yes, so we've been able to do a lot of internal R&D, but that was leveraging resources that General Motors already had. So, I mean, we were 3D printing things, we were working with advanced development. So we had, I mean, the group collectively, we did a patent count the other day, and the team members have 117 patents. Within just what we've done for Maven since January, we have 7. And so it's pretty remarkable how much intellectual property, and again, I don't think OEMs get enough credit for how much intellectual property is generated, but Maven's been definitely a hotbed for that within GM. And we're now looking at how we can leverage that back into the core automotive business as well.
So you're a hardcore you know, JLR guy, B2B kind of...
I'm never going to shed that, am I? No. I've been in automotive.
Do you have any B2C background, or are you learning as you go?
Well, as far as I see it, every car...
I know you have a big heart, Matt.
Every car that I ever worked on, all of the work that we did with the Linux Foundation and the Geneva Alliance, is about that end consumer. And if we think about how the consumer's expectations have changed just in the last 9 years, really since that first iPhone came out, the expectation of a vehicle isn't based on their previous car. It's not really based on the competition now. It's based on their consumer electronics experiences, the movie theater, their home entertainment, but mostly the smart device in their pocket. And I actually think it's great that we're getting new blood, fresh blood into automotive that can relate to some of the life experiences that ultimately drivers and passengers and transit users have. And that's some of what automotive has been missing. But really, we've been kicked into action from the connected, the autonomous, the electric, all of these new technologies coming together at the same point in time with a total change in the customer's expectations based on the consumer electronics has led to all of these different startups, including our startup, Car2Go. All of this future play has become even more critical. And we could almost give credit to Tesla and Tesla-like companies as well for acting as the disruptors. Obviously, as Daimler and GM, but at the same point in time, they've helped us move forward. You're not allowed to say that from your PR department?
Yeah.
Okay, hands up. Got
neutral.
It. But it's really exciting to see all of the different startups outside thinking about new technologies that 10 years ago they couldn't have dreamed of integrating into a car. 5-year development timescales, that's not going to work for anybody going forwards. And it's really good to start to see that car as a platform with the semi-autonomous and the autonomous features coming forwards so that we can have these shared ownership models and we can have multimodal transit. And I think it was one of the guests we had on the last panel was saying it's about the utilization. And he's absolutely right. A Boeing 747 can cost $247 million based on 20 hours in the air a day. An S-Class can appeal to a certain demographic based on its cost. But everybody wants to own an S-Class. And if through shared ownership and leveraging the multiple buying power of multiple people, we can actually start to afford the autonomous sensor networks that add a significant cost to a vehicle, we will get more rapid adoption going forwards. And that kind of excites me as well with some of the technology that probably both of us are working on individually.
So some of these mobile mobility services propositions are kind of head scratchers, you know, both you know, spectacularly interesting and head scratching at the same time. So Lyft and Uber, basically it's a cheap taxi that comes via an app. So why couldn't you just get a taxi instead of an Uber or a Lyft, right? It's just cheaper and maybe a newer car because they're just starting. Similarly, car sharing, why are you going to have car sharing? All the research says people are going to buy fewer cars if they can just get a car and use it on an ad hoc basis on the street. You're actively a Daimler division pushing people towards public transportation. Mm-hmm. So how do you respond to this? Because it doesn't seem to make any sense. Because car companies, I've been told time and again, we want to sell cars. We want to push the metal. So what's your response to that? Oh, Rachel's dishing the ball to you.
She's
first.
Itching to answer this one, but I'm going to go first.
Go.
We got 360 million people, roughly speaking, in just the US alone, and we're still buying cars. And we know with the millennials, when millennials start to have children, discover they need a stroller and a trunk full of diapers, they start to buy cars.
Let's make no mistake. You are aggressively pushing people to public transportation.
Yes. In the US, today, in San Francisco, in Virginia, in Chicago. And we're going to continue to do that because we have to do that because people will not buy cars, not all of the people,
but,
and we have to translate.
You know what I'm talking about. All the studies say. Mm-hmm.
And in the future, we will open up
cars.
Future markets across the globe, and ultimately, we will have shared ownership and open this up to a wider variety of people across the globe. It can't grow forever. Ultimately, this is Daimler's way of saying, we get that. Daimler do produce buses. We're not going to lie. We'd love to sell more of those as well. Is that the same for...
I knew it.
You've got a slightly advantage.
Slight overlap.
We're not going into trains yet. Maybe you could take the trains. We'll take buses.
Okay, it's all making sense now. Buses.
It's not. Okay. It's a case of we know it has to change. We know the customer expectations are changing. We would rather be the change than wait to be disrupted. Okay. And Moovel, Car2Go, my taxi in Europe, we're part of that change. We're part of that disruption. We're still playing to keep up with some of the real disruptors in Silicon Valley, but by partnering, by collaborating, we'll actually make a bigger difference going forward.
Okay, I'm Mary Barr, and I'm looking at the reports, report after report. 5 to 8 car purchases deferred or deleted for every shared car put on the road.
And you're like, what is Mary thinking?
Why are we doing this?
Yeah, no, we get asked.
Where's Rachel? Get Rachel in here right now.
I'm pretty sure she's not mad at me. So I get asked this a lot, and a couple of answers. First, car sharing is inherently more of an adjacency, frankly, to our core business. I mean, it's still the production of vehicles and the individual occupancy of them. That said, there are two big sources of value here. One of them is that, candidly, there are individuals who are in a stage of their life where they don't own a vehicle, nor do they wish to. When I lived in downtown Seattle, I did not own a vehicle. I did not need to. However, when I wanted to go hiking or I wanted to go to IKEA, I needed to borrow a friend's car, and that was a bit of a pain, right? So what we're able to do through Maven is round out the portfolio. So now somebody that who before would never have been a customer has the opportunity to be in a new, great, well-outfitted, well-equipped vehicle and have an amazing experience. And our rental is between, on average, 12 to 15 hours. So this is someone that's in the car for a good period of time. We've had people name them, people get emotionally attached. And the idea is certainly when that individual does, like the rest of us, move to the suburbs eventually, you know, have a child, you do get to a life point where having a vehicle does make sense, and now they know that we have great cars. If you ignore the change that's coming, I cannot agree more. The idea is to be the change agent such that you're controlling your destiny. The other part that I think is overlooked is nascent fractional demand. So if I need a large car 2% of the time, right? I personally drive a very small car. I like small cars from the West Coast, but if you need a car very, very rarely, you would never buy it. But if many people need a car 2%, 5% of the time, we can now monetize that by virtue of offering fractional and shared use. So that's demand that today would be met by, again, borrowing the friend's car or some other solution in which we are not economically participating, and now we are. So I think that there's really two sources of value at it.
And well, this isn't really just about the car sharing. If you think about the way we organize bus services around routes at set.
Well, I think about what you're about to touch on is the data gathering aspect of this.
We can do that as well.
Oh, that might be part of the story,
yeah.
Maybe?
But ultimately, the data gathering is helping all of these different transit agencies to put the right services in the right places. So where we have the bus services running at 15-minute regular intervals, I was going to get this in whichever way Roger went. The data that we're collecting and that even Uber and Lyft and others are collecting are helping municipalities work out how to run on-demand bus services. And we've seen the announcements recently that Uber are effectively taking over some of those routes. And we shouldn't see that as a threat, because ultimately this is providing a service to people that will never own a car, people that are the underserved today, and it's helping them, making a real difference to their lives. And if we can use the data that we have from car sharing, from Moovel-like services from where people want to get from A to B to arrange on-demand buses to serve the underserved, again, that's going to make it better for all of us in the city.
You talked about something that has very significant implications when we were talking earlier about actually using the infrastructure that you've created to manage the transportation landscape. So you were talking about Stuttgart and pollution or?
Yeah, so in Stuttgart at the moment, using the Moovel app, you can plot your route from a hotel to an office. It will give you all of the different choices for public transit as well as shared rides or Car2Go type services. And you can choose based on time, based on cost. It gives you the options, walk here, take this bus route, or walk 2 minutes more, take this bus route. And then ultimately in Stuttgart and to a certain extent in Hamburg, we have this concept where you can pay for that entire ride in one go. Now that's incredibly difficult to do, as I'm sure you're more than aware.
In other words, the opposite of surge pricing from Uber?
Indeed, yeah. So this is a one-stop shop where the opposite of surge pricing, as we tried in Stuttgart. Stuttgart's in a valley, and now and again it gets very smoggy, to say the least. The air quality's very, very poor. And Moovel, working with the local city, effectively said, we will subsidize people's public transit rides on one of these spikes to drive people to public transit, to leave their internal combustion engine at home and to try and help the city problem.
Now, Rachel, you mentioned rolling out additional services. You know, it sounds like things are moving very quickly. Are there some other sort of use cases or usage propositions? I'm not aware of any plan for GM to create a multimodal story, but maybe there is.
I think I would not be able to speak to it if we were. But no, I mean, what struck me as Matt was talking is actually the attitude we're seeing towards EVs and environmental impact within our customer base. And I think there's often this somewhat stereotypical vision, oh, General Motors, it's all just trucks and SUVs, trucks and SUVs. And in reality, what we're finding within Maven is the Volt is our single most popular vehicle. Like, that's what our customers are choosing. And now that we're coming out with the Bolt, we're already seeing advanced questions and demand, and when can I get this? And I think there's, given that you're talking about people that do live in urban environments, they're more aware, I think, of environmental impact, as well as we skew younger, we skew millennial. And I think there is a really great appetite in a customer group where you can expose them to a great electric vehicle in such a way that you're ensuring the longevity of that business, as opposed to, I'm gonna go try and scattershot this, right? I mean, we can really go right after people that we know to be receptive to the technology and interested in environmental impact.
And the one of the aspects that doesn't get talked about a whole lot is the idea of the car as an amenity for your apartment building.
Yes.
Is that something that's relatively new? I mean, and is that growing very rapidly?
I think with zoning changes as well as just building code in some cities, you are definitely seeing a trend towards a lower ratio of parking spots to dwelling units. And so we have a lot of developers that are very keen to offer this as an amenity. And the model there ranges from it's completely subsidized by the building in question as an amenity to innovative billing models based on usage or thresholds. And so we can accommodate all of that. Again, it's another market where we see a lot of interest in EVs.
And am I the only one that sees a huge opportunity from emerging markets where no one really has a lot of car sharing activity right now?
Absolutely not.
Yeah,
and
no.
This is why we really need to get it right in the US and Europe, so that we can drive the cost down and make it affordable for these emerging markets. And that's one of the challenges, that the cost of a smart city in the US is never going to translate to the likes of Addis Ababa or Ethiopia. But ultimately, where is the growing population? Where are the next megacities? They're not going to be in the US or Europe. They are in these emerging markets. And if we can fix it at the right price point and make it affordable here, and then cookie cutter stamp that into Rio, into Brasilia.
It might be shared tuk-tuks and motorcycles, though.
It could well be, but obviously Mercedes and GM do a lovely range of 4x4s that may be suitable for the more third world road systems. But ultimately, these services are still applicable to everybody on the planet. The biggest difference that we will drive will not be in Chicago or LA or Detroit. It will be in the likes of Bangalore, in the Singapore. These different areas where there's a far lower expectation of owning a car. And ultimately, I come back to the fact we all use the same smartphones.
I'm going to have one more question for you and then see if we have any questions from the audience. Mm-hmm. And that is there a role for the dealer in this program? Are the dealers going to benefit? Do they want to participate? Do they understand what's going on?
So there's definitely a role for the dealer in the program. In literal terms, we partner with the dealers today in all of our programs. And so I think from a philosophical perspective, yes, I mean, that's a critical relationship, I think, for every manufacturer right now. But also from just a practical perspective, that's an amazing asset. I mean, we have people that are highly trained technicians, the supply chain is there. And the idea that you would ignore that group, I think, would be just a very poor business decision. So when we think about thousands of vehicles that we have deployed across the United States right now, we want to ensure that they are safe. We want to ensure that they're properly inspected. We don't want any questions in that regard. And so for us, being able to turn to our dealers as our source for much of our, if not all, of our maintenance and repair is really a major asset for us. And yes, to your question, I think they do see the opportunity. We have separate pilots with dealers going on right now, which has to do with taking their, test drive fleets and monetizing that sort of nascent supply. So they have these cars that they don't use when they're closed. You can unlock that and let them monetize it by using the Maven platform. So we have all kinds of partnerships going on with dealerships.
There's a lot more to talk about, but unfortunately we don't have any time. But there is time for a question or two. I don't know if we're going to do that. Oh, here comes one. All right, Stacy.
Hi, Rachel. So Maven, I had the opportunity to try it in San Francisco. In fact, I was one of the lucky ones who was the first one to drive the car and got the water bottle. Very nice touch.
Yes, you're welcome.
but I'm wondering if you're looking at any other models beyond the one use, one time thing, like more of a subscription or something that you could see a family incorporating into their use. So much of what I see today is geared towards millennials and what they do and don't do, but there are lots of people that aren't millennials and have different use cases.
Certainly, and I would say we're open to exploring all business models, of course. I think today it is geared towards the pay-as-you-go as opposed to a subscription for the simple reason that the majority of our customers have expressed that for them that's what makes the most sense. I think especially as someone is new and is trying the service, it's important to them to have that flexibility, and so we've just ensured that they have that flexibility. But especially as we think about commercial applications, as we think about it's funny for me, when I think about autonomous, one of my thoughts immediately goes to a neighborhood-owned car as an example. I mean, you can think of these interesting use cases that would be more of a subscription. But no, for today, we've kept it, frankly, our priority has been flexibility for our customers because that's been what we've heard from them the most, and that's why we've landed on the business model that we've landed on.
Any other questions? Last chance? Last call? Okay, well, please thank my panelists, and we'll see who's up next. Thank you.